he'd like to change America. And a pandemic. I know that the incoming administration has said they like to pursue a two-pronged strategy with a massive stimulus followed by tax hikes coupled with even more spending, and particularly they mentioned infrastructure. We're already closely examining President-elect Biden's proposal for around 1 9/10 trillion of stimulus, which even some prominent Democrat economists have said does not seem to be well targeted. With the trillions of already in the pipeline and close to $1 trillion in relief enacted just a few short weeks ago, it is very important to focus efforts on pandemic relief. Now is not the time to enact a laundry list of liberal structural economic reforms. Dr. Yellen, if you're confirmed, I hope that you'll work with us on that proposal. Moving forward, President-elect Biden has stated numerous times that no one making under $400,000 would see their taxes raised. For example, last year on CNBC, President-elect Biden stated that we can think what we can think of as the new Biden rule that, quote, nobody making under $400,000, and he said bucks, would have their taxes raised, period, end of quote. While I don't think we need to be raising taxes, I'll pay close attention to see that the incoming administration abides by that new Biden rule and doesn't go after taxing small businesses and the middle class. On my part, let me tell you that I believe in free and fair trade both internationally and domestically. International trade is important to American businesses and especially important to the agricultural sector and the farmers across America. I will make sure that the incoming administration does not overlook the importance of agriculture or the interest of rural America. I'm against foreign countries trying to tap into the U.S. tax base with unilateral digital services taxes under their self-proclaimed rights to invade our tax base. They don't have that right. I don't support socialism or Marxism or so-called democratic socialism that would end with command and control policies. I also don't support any rapid or drastic wiping out of industries and their workers based mostly on ideology and often on misleading analyses with some notion of taking care of the carnage through massive government income and wealth redistribution. Prior to the pandemic, although there were economic and structural challenges to the economy, we saw a very historic 50-year low in unemployment rates, record lows in gaps between minority unemployment and the overall unemployment rate, inclusive growth with real wages growing faster for lower earners, record highs in real medium household income, stronger medium income growth for minorities than others, and reductions in income inequality and poverty. While those are goals of Democrats, we did not hear much about the accomplishments from members of the other party. Those accomplishments came about in an environment in which tax burdens were lowered and made more progressive, and regulation was made more efficient. Instead of welcoming the accomplishments, we have heard from the other side that we need to change America. I would like to see us continue with the accomplishments we saw prior to the pandemic. Now let me close with a comment on transparency. This committee has traditionally expressed bipartisan interest in reminding all nominees who come before this committee that transparency is important to our members. That means that I expect that you will respond to inquiries from any senator on this committee, no matter which side of the aisle they sit. Prompt and thorough responses to our inquiries and investigations is what we expect. With that, now Senator White.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and I want to begin, Chairman Grassley, by thanking you and Senator Crapo for the help in scheduling Chair Yellen's hearing this morning. And Senator Grassley, I also want to thank you for joining me last week in exposing the pharmaceutical companies' insulin price gouging schemes. America knows that they're getting mugged at the pharmacy counter. Now, this committee can use a fresh investigation that helps lay out a plan to finally end one of the all-time big anti-consumer ripoffs, which is what's going on with insulin. Mr. Chairman, I thank you for that. Now, to turn to Chair Yellen, this is the second time in 12 years that a Republican president leaves office with the economy in ruins. Today, there's also a surging pandemic and armed troops guarding our capital from far-right insurrectionist attack. The Biden administration isn't going to begin with inaugural balls. It's going to begin with all-out triage. My top economic priority is avoiding the mistake Congress made in the last recession, which was taking a foot off the gas pedal before recovery took hold. Congress didn't do enough in 2009 to help the unemployed and struggling homeowners. And if stepping off the gas wasn't bad enough, 2 years later, House Republicans passed policies that yanked out the spark plugs and let the air out of the tires as well. In Oregon, it took 7.5 years for unemployment to return to its pre-recession level. That cannot happen again, or else millions and millions of people will go through years of needless hardship. Some will never recover the lives that they had prior to the pandemic. Unemployment is again rising. Federal Reserve data shows that workers of modest incomes are facing Great Depression-level joblessness. 1 out of 5 are out of work. And Donald Trump repeatedly pressed a false and manipulative choice between public health and economic recovery, and now America has neither. The good news is Chair Yellen knows that going small on economic relief would be a big mistake. Chair Yellen is exactly the right person to lead the Treasury Department. Nobody could be better qualified for this job. And Mr. Chairman, I would ask unanimous consent at this point to put into the record a letter signed by 8 former living Treasury secretaries urging swift confirmation of Janet Yellen.
Without objection, so ordered.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I just say to my colleagues, all of those Treasury secretaries don't just come together by osmosis. They believe deeply in the challenge ahead of us in this country, and they all think Janet Yellen is up to the job. And nobody deserves more credit than Chair Yellen for the longest economic expansion that we have seen in our history, which lasted until the pandemic hit. At the Federal Reserve, Chair Yellen changed decades of conventional economic wisdom that put too much focus on inflation and deficits. She was correct that policymakers should focus more on wages, employment, and inequality, and that the economy safely could run a little hotter. Now, she took some heat at the time from Republicans, but later they tried to attribute Janet Yellen's success to the outgoing administration. But the numbers show the successes of Chair Yellen's approach. Unemployment went down, wages went up, and a lot of working Americans were better off than they were before. Who better to lead the Treasury Department and help kick off the next economic expansion than the person who did so much to bring about the last one? Right out of the gate, the Biden administration and Congress need to send major relief to America's working families. That means increasing relief checks to $2,000, and it means extending enhanced unemployment benefits to all of those who've lost their job through no fault of their own. At Mitch McConnell's insistence, the December economic package reduced unemployment benefits from the CARES Act and extended them only until the middle of March. There are groceries in my refrigerator that are going to last longer than Mitch McConnell's unemployment agenda. Now, this has been a common story of late in Washington. Key economic lifelines expire, they get extended. They expire, they get extended. Congress cannot go on with this snooze button legislating. Our workers and our economy need a government that's predictable and reliable. That means the Congress needs to tether the extension of unemployment benefits to economic conditions on the ground with automatic triggers. Those benefits should not be subject to the whim of one elected official. The tattered patchwork of state unemployment insurance systems also needs fixing. My home state of Oregon saw this when the COVID crash hit. In other cases, it was because Republican lawmakers have intentionally hobbled unemployment insurance programs. Workers suffer because of it, particularly Black and Hispanic workers. Congress needs to reform the program, which I think should include bringing all workers into the system, increasing base benefits, and ensuring that it can hold up in a crisis. Also, part of our work has to involve fixing America's broken down, dysfunctional tax code. And to me, it has to start with the proposition that billionaires, corporations, millionaires have to pay their fair share. I'm developing a proposal to reform the taxation of capital gains for the top 0.3% of taxpayers. My plan would tax wealth like work, and it would minimize the ability of those who are particularly well off and have all the accountants and all the lawyers to just defer and defer and defer paying their taxes. If you're a nurse, and I was just home for the last close to 10 days in virtual town halls and talking to folks in a socially distant way, And one of the things I discussed is, if you're a nurse in Oregon taking care of COVID patients, you have to pay taxes with every paycheck. You don't get to defer your taxes if you're a nurse treating COVID patients. But if you're a billionaire, you can defer and defer and defer paying taxes. And in many instances, figure out a way to pay nothing at all. My plan would put a stop to that unfairness, and the revenue would help preserve the Social Security guarantee for decades to come, with additional funds for other priorities. Now, the outgoing administration had a different approach. They were big on corporate tax giveaways, and they actually increased incentives to ship jobs overseas instead of eliminating them. I want those mistakes fixed. Before I wrap up, I want to turn to an existential threat for particularly our kids and our grandkids, and that is climate change. Treasury Department's going to have a key role to play on these climate issues. Much of America's energy policy is tax policy. Having worked with my friend from Washington State, Senator Cantwell, we know there are now 44 energy tax breaks on the books. And some of them look like they just came from yesteryear. I've got a bill to replace these 44 breaks with three that go right to the heart of a new set of priorities: reducing carbon emissions, promoting innovation. The three are clean electricity, clean transportation, and energy conservation. I'm also developing a proposal that would make polluters pay for the costs of climate change, with much of the revenue returned directly to the American people through annual cash payments. The Treasury Department plays a big role, as Chairman Grassley noted, in trade. Over the last 4 years, the American people got a lot of tough talk about trade, but there was a big gap between the tough talk and delivering on the big promises. This administration drove away our economic allies. It actually isolated us in the crucial fight against trade cheats in China and elsewhere. Members of this committee are also concerned about currency manipulation and other tactics that rip off high-skill, high-wage jobs at a time when wage growth has got to be right at the top of our economic agenda. I'm looking forward to working with a Secretary Yellen on all these issues and more, and I certainly hope, and Chairman Grassley and I have been talking about it, that with her stellar, extraordinary qualifications, we can get her nomination approved as quickly as possible. And it seems to me, with the economic crunch we're facing, it ought to be approved on day one. Now, I'll close by saying everybody's got a constitutional right to be foolish, but nobody can question Chair Yellen's qualifications. This country has never had a woman as Treasury Secretary. What a shame. Anybody who doubts Chair Yellen's commitment to policies that give everybody a chance to get ahead just hasn't been paying attention. So, colleagues, I look forward to working with all the members, Democrats and Republicans, throughout this session. And I think it's very appropriate that we begin with somebody, with the consideration of a person who's so extraordinarily qualified and who I very much appreciate being willing to return to public service. President-elect Biden could not have made a better choice, colleagues, than Janet Yellen. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. The chair now recognizes and welcomes Senator Feinstein from California for the purposes of introduction.
Thanks.
And I thank the chair. Thank you very much, Senator, and other senators. It's just fine to be here this morning. I've known Janet since she became president of the president of the Federal Reserve Bank of San Francisco in 2004. She's been
all the members, Democrats and Republicans, throughout this session. And I think it's very appropriate that we begin with somebody, with the consideration of a person who's so extraordinarily qualified and who I very much appreciate being willing to return to public service. President-elect Biden could not have made a better choice, colleagues, than Janet Yellen. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. The chair now recognizes and welcomes Senator Feinstein from California for the purposes of introduction.
Thanks.
And I thank the chair. Thank you very much, Senator, and other senators. It's just fine to be here this morning. I've known Janet since she became president of the Federal Reserve Bank of San Francisco in 2004. She's been professor, now emeritus, at the University of California, Berkeley, since 1980. That's 40 years. Janet has an impressive record. She served twice on the Federal Reserve Board of Governors and was the first woman to chair the Fed from 2014 to 2018. She also served as chair of the Council of Economic Advisors under President Clinton, and she is currently professor emeritus at the University of California, Berkeley, as well as a distinguished fellow at the Brookings Institution. Some have joked that Janet's husband, 42 years, George, won the Nobel Prize in Economic Sciences, yet he is regarded by many as the second most accomplished economist in his own home. But it can be said that all of these accomplishments did not come easily for a woman in the male-dominated field of economics. Out of 24 students who received doctorates in economics at Yale in 1971, Janet was the only woman, and she has been a trailblazer her entire career. Now she brings to us the experience and leadership needed at Treasury at this critical juncture. I believe that Janet Yellen really understands that the economy is not an abstract series of charts and figures, but a collection of real individuals, families, communities, problems, businesses who need help. And there are many reasons that Janet received bipartisan praise when President-elect Biden announced her nomination in December. For one, her deep policy expertise matches her understanding of the impact of economic policy on people. She's also a pragmatic and steady hand who recognizes the need for fiscal discipline. In short, she is the ideal candidate to head Treasury at a time when we can afford nothing less. So I urge and hope that this committee will rapidly approve her nomination. And I thank you for the privilege, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Feinstein. I want to go back to Senator Wyden because he asked to speak on another point before I go to Yellen.
Mr. Chairman, just on your point earlier, because we need to get to Chair Yellen, I very much share your view with respect to transparency. You and I have worked on those issues. I also want to put on the record that the Treasury's record over the past 4 years on this was dismal on things like FinCEN. We've got to do better. Let's do it in a bipartisan way. Thank you.
Bet. Thank you very much. Now, I didn't congratulate Dr. Yellen on her appointment. I do that now and ask her to make her opening statement.
He was the kind of doctor who treated the whole patient. He knew about their lives, about when they'd been fired or couldn't pay. Those remain some of the clearest moments in my childhood. My parents had been children of the Depression, and they had a visceral reaction to economic hardship. Economics is sometimes considered a dry subject, but I've always tried to approach my science the same way my father approached his, as a means to help people. And this committee, I believe, has viewed it the same way, especially during these last few months. When economists look back on the pandemic, I expect they'll conclude that Congress's actions averted a lot of suffering. But more must be done. Economists don't always agree, but I think there is a consensus now. Without further action, we risk a longer, more painful recession now and longer-term scarring of the economy later. The pandemic has caused widespread devastation. Whole industries have paused their work. 18 million unemployment insurance claims are being paid every week. Food bank shelves are going empty. The damage has been sweeping. And as the president-elect said last Thursday, our response must be too. Over the next few months, we're going to need more aid to distribute the vaccine, to reopen schools, to help states keep firefighters and teachers on the job. We'll need more funding to make sure unemployment insurance checks still go out and to help families who are at risk of going hungry or losing the roof over their heads. Neither the president-elect nor I proposed this relief package without an appreciation for the country's debt burden. But right now, with interest rates at historic lows, the smartest thing we can do is act big. In the long run, I believe the benefits will far outweigh the costs, especially if we care about helping people who have been struggling for a very long time. People worry about a K-shaped recovery, but well before COVID-19 infected a single American, we were living in a K-shaped economy, one where wealth built upon wealth, while working families fell farther and farther behind. This is especially true for people of color. At the Fed, I became accustomed to the institution's dual mandate to promote stable prices and maximum employment. As Treasury Secretary, I think there will be a dual mission too, helping Americans endure the final months of this pandemic, keeping people safe while getting them back to work. That's our first task. But then there's the longer term project. We have to rebuild our economy so that it creates more prosperity for more people and ensures that American workers can compete in an increasingly competitive global economy. Members of the committee, these are very ambitious goals, and I know we will need to work together. You can count on me to do that in a bipartisan way. My husband and son are watching us on C-SPAN from the other room. They are not only wonderful people, they're also wonderful and opinionated economists themselves. So I'm used to debate about these issues in the House, and I'd welcome it in the Senate. Thank you. I look forward to your questions. No, Senator Grassley, I don't believe I have any conflict of interest.
reason, personal or otherwise, that would in any way prevent you from fully and honorably discharging the responsibilities of the office to which you have been nominated?
No, I do not.
Do you agree without reservation to respond to any reasonable summons to appear and testify before any duly constituted committee of the Congress if you're confirmed?
I will testify if asked before a committee of Congress.
And finally, do you commit to providing a
Yes, I commit to that. Any conflict of interest?
Yeah. Okay. Do you know any reason, personal or otherwise, that would in any way prevent you from fully and honorably discharging the responsibilities of the office to which you have been nominated?
No, I do not.
Do you agree without reservation to respond to any reasonable summons to appear and testify before any duly constituted committee of the Congress if you're confirmed?
I will testify if asked before a committee of Congress.
And finally, do you commit to providing a prompt response in writing to any questions addressed to you by any senator of this committee?
Yes, I commit to that.
Yeah. In regard to that last one, I think Senator Biden, as senator, would agree with me that when the Trump administration first came in, they issued some sort of a regulation that they were going to only answer questions for committee chairmen. We finally got them off of it. I don't know whether they answered every question of every senator or not. They probably did not. But I hope that we don't hear that from this administration, that you have to be chairman of a committee to get to be an answer to your question. Before I ask the first question, but it's kind of along the lines of the question I was going to ask you, I just heard your opening comment about learning so much from your father about the workers of America and about the business of America. I hope you will continually remind people that you have that background and you take it into consideration every opportunity you can, because I think people think of you being in public service for such a long time may have forgotten that, just like I think a lot of people think that that after Chuck Grassley's been in the United States Senate for 40 years, he's forgotten the 10 years he spent on the assembly line with the workers of Iowa. And it's important that they be reminded of these backgrounds. Dr. Yellen, how will you work at Treasury to ensure that the interests of American workers and businesses in rural America aren't ignored?
Senator Grassley, thank you for that question. It will be my core focus if I'm confirmed as Treasury Secretary to focus on the needs of America's workers, those living in cities and in rural areas, and to make sure that we have a competitive economy that offers good jobs and good wages. And I really look forward to working with President-elect Biden and his team first to address the critical issues we face as a country now, with the pandemic causing such misery for so many small businesses that have failed, are at risk of failing, need our help, and the unemployed workers who have been so badly affected by the impact of the pandemic, especially on the service sector. It's disproportionately hit the service sector and the workers who are employed in that sector, and it's been particularly brutal in its impact on minorities and on women. and I will be focused from day one on providing support to America's workers and to small businesses, putting into effect as quickly and efficiently as I can the relief in the bill that was recently passed, and then over time, working for a second package that I think we need to get through these dark times before the vaccination program enables us to go back to life as we knew it. But over time, I look forward to working with President-elect Biden and his team to build back better and to address many of the challenges that have faced America that have had such an adverse impact on America's workers and small businesses. We need to invest in our infrastructure. We need to invest in R&D. We need to invest in training and workforce development so that we have an economy that is productive and competitive and workers and families can thrive.
Please. Thank you very much for that question. That was kind of a shotgun approach to questioning. I now have a rifle approach. Democrats have been arguing for repeal of the $10,000 cap on state and local tax deductions, often referred to as SALT, even as part of a pandemic relief effort. Yet even left-leaning commentators, such as Tax Policy Center, point out that a SALT repeal would provide the top 0.1% of households with an average tax cut of about $144,000, with essentially no benefit going to bottom half of the household earners. Do you think it makes sense for the pandemic relief efforts to prioritize six-figure tax cuts for the wealthiest few when millions of middle-class American families are struggling to make ends meet? And would you oppose including a repeal of the SALT cap in any further relief or stimulus measure?
Senator Grassley, thank you for that question. I certainly believe in a fair and progressive tax code where wealthy individuals and corporations pay their fair share. The SALT deduction was the SALT deduction was eliminated only a few years ago, and before making a decision about what should be done going forward, I think it's critical to study and evaluate what the impact has been on state and local governments, on their ability to provide critical services. And I promise to work with those at Treasury and throughout the administration in evaluating what impact that has had on states and local governments, on households, on small businesses, and study this issue further.
I've got to go to Senator Wyden now. My next question would have dealt with an issue that he and I have worked very closely on in regard to the unfair digital service tax that we see other companies putting on our country. And I'll submit questions like that for answer in writing. Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Chair Yellen, great to have you in the virtual house. And I'm going to see if I can cover a fair amount of ground quickly. I think we all understand that the country has been hit by an economic wrecking ball. And so my first question to you would be, what economic policies will give Americans the biggest bang for the buck in the immediate term?
Well, I think relief that we provide to those who are in the greatest need and to small businesses have the best chance of providing both relief to those who've been so badly affected by the pandemic and by creating a great deal of spending per dollar spent, they'll create jobs throughout the economy, having the biggest buck, so biggest bang for the buck. So I see, for example, extended unemployment insurance, SNAP benefits, and so forth as having a very large buck. Of course, in a way, the biggest bang per buck comes from the money we spend on public health to make sure that we have widespread vaccinations quickly so schools can reopen and we can get past the pandemic and reopen businesses and the economy safely and avoid scarring that will occur if there's permanent job loss.
Good. I also appreciate your comment with respect to extended unemployment, because that's one of the policies that allows us in the future, in terms of reform, to tie benefits to economic conditions on the ground. So it gives you time to fully get us to that longer term economic recovery. So that's very helpful. Second question I want to talk to you about is China, because we all understand that China cheating is taking a huge toll on our workers and particularly creating more high-paying jobs. Now, I think that the president-elect is absolutely on the right course, saying he's going to mobilize the allies to work with us in terms of dealing with China. That's going to take a little bit of time. So what I'd like to hear from you again is, in the near term, what do you believe you can do, perhaps your first couple of steps, to start to mobilize our country to make sure that workers get a fair shake in view of all this China economic cheating?
Well, China is clearly our most important strategic competitor. As you said, we need to work with allies. We also need to strengthen our own economy so that we can compete. And President-elect Biden will soon come forward with a package to accomplish that by investing in our infrastructure, investing in our people, creating a more competitive economy in research and development. We need to take on China's abusive, unfair, and illegal practices. China's undercutting American companies by dumping products, erecting trade barriers, and giving illegal subsidies to corporations. It's been stealing intellectual property and engaging in practices that give it an unfair technological advantage, including forced technology transfers. And these practices, including China's low labor and environmental standards, are practices that we're prepared to use the full array of tools to address. Of course, it is important over time to work with our allies.
Very good. I'm going to see if I can get two other questions in and go maybe 30 seconds over like the chairman. You heard me talk with respect to climate change about refocusing our tax code so we can really zero in on eliminating carbon emissions. Can you give us one step that you think you could begin with to tackle this climate question?
Well, this is one of the most critical issues facing our country and the world, and it poses an existential threat. It will be a focus of President-elect Biden and his entire administration. The infrastructure plan that President Biden will come forward with will involve investing in clean technology, renewable energy, promoting the use of electric vehicles. And in the process of addressing this very significant challenge, there's also the opportunity of creating good jobs in the process. And that will be a benefit. Treasury will cooperate by looking at ways that we can direct investment, enable private firms to have the information they need to support sustainable investing.
One last question very quickly. The Wall Street Journal is reporting on a plan or your comments to affirm the United States' commitment to a market-determined exchange rate if you're confirmed. So obviously, Americans are interested in your thoughts on the dollar. Could you briefly outline for the committee your thoughts on the dollar?
Thank you, Senator Wyden. I believe in a strong and equitable U.S. economy that delivers good jobs with rising wages for all Americans. Maintaining confidence in the long-term strength of the U.S. economy and the stability of the U.S. financial system is good for America, as well as our trading and investing partners. I look forward to working with Congress to make the U.S. economic recovery as strong as possible. I believe in market-determined exchange rates. The value of the U.S. dollar and other currencies should be determined by markets. Markets adjust to reflect variations in economic performance and generally facilitate adjustments in the global economy. The United States does not seek a weaker currency to gain competitive advantage, and we should oppose attempts by other countries to do so. The intentional targeting of exchange rates to gain advantage is unacceptable. If confirmed, I will work to implement the president-elect's promise to oppose any and all attempts by foreign countries to artificially manipulate currency values to gain an unfair advantage in trade.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I'm going to turn the gavel over to Senator Crapo. He'll be the next person to ask questions. Republicans have a rule that you can only be chairman of a committee for 6 years, and so this could be the last hearing as chairman of the committee, and it's been a great privilege to chair one of the most important committees in Congress. I first joined this committee in 1981 during the 102nd Congress and became chairman briefly in 2001 before switching party membership changed the balance, and then chaired it two times since. I'll continue to serve on this committee, of course, but leading this committee has been one of the highlights of my years in the Senate. Once the Senate organizes, Ranking Member Wyden will become chairman, but as I turn the gavel over to Senator Crapo, I know this committee will be well in good hands of Senator Wyden and Senator Crapo over the next 2 years. Thank you very much, Senator Crapo.
Well, thank you very much, Senator Grassley. I want to commend him, even though he just stepped out of the room, for his great service and for the opportunity to serve under his leadership as the chairman. And I'll just take a brief moment here to say Senator Wyden and I have worked together for years on a bipartisan basis and have built a lot of really big successes. I look forward to working with you, Senator Wyden, as we move forward. And Dr. Yellen, I appreciate your service. I've worked with you as well, as you know. When we discussed this a little while back, we had a good working relationship while you were at the Fed, and I look forward to developing and continuing that good working relationship as we move forward. My first question is going to be on tax policy. Prior to the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act, the TCJA, the United States had one of the highest corporate tax rates among developed countries. As a part of the TCJA, Congress lowered the corporate tax rate to ensure that our domestic businesses could remain globally competitive. But even now, the corporate tax rate in America is still the 11th highest among developed countries, according to the Tax Policy Center. As a result of the COVID-19 pandemic, U.S. companies are struggling to stay in business and to keep employees on payroll. President-elect Biden's proposals include a significant increase in the corporate tax rate that would hit already vulnerable businesses and put U.S. companies, once again, at a strong competitive disadvantage with the rest of the world. What is your view of raising taxes on struggling businesses during the COVID-19 pandemic?
Well, thank you for that question, Senator Crapo. And I too want to say that I have enjoyed my working relationship with you during my years at the Fed and look forward to a very productive working relationship going forward. On the 2017 tax cuts, the president has said that eventually, as part of a larger package that would include significant spending and investment proposals, but not now, while the pandemic is really depressing the economy, that he would want to repeal parts of the 2017 tax cuts that benefited the highest income Americans and large companies. And he wants to reverse the law's incentives to offshore operations and profits. But he's been very clear that he does not support a complete repeal of the 2017 tax law. There are some areas, though, that he would amend. For example, a provision in that law had the unfortunate byproduct of rewarding companies for moving their operations offshore, and the president would reverse that. We look forward to actively working with other countries through the OECD negotiations on taxes on multinational corporations to try to stop what has been a destructive global race to the bottom on corporate taxation. And in that context, we would assure the competitiveness of American corporations, even with a somewhat higher corporate tax.
Well, I appreciate that last observation. As we discussed on the phone last week, I encouraged you to make as one of your top considerations for any changes to our business tax policies the competitiveness of the U.S. businesses and the need to make sure that the United States remains an attractive place for investment and capital formation and job creation. So I look forward to working with you on that. Can you explain again your views on the importance of these kinds?
And that's why these OECD negotiations are so important. It would enable us to collect a fair share from corporations while maintaining the competitiveness of our businesses and diminish the incentives that American companies now have to offshore activities. That's certainly something we don't want to reward.
Well, I look forward to working with you on those OECD negotiations and the other aspects of tax policy that we've just discussed. One last quick question. As chairman of the Banking Committee, I worked in a bipartisan manner to pass the Foreign Investment Risk Review Modernization Act, the Export Control Reform Act, and as part of the NDAA, the Anti-Money Laundering Act of 2021. The Treasury Department plays a major role in implementing these statutes and managing our relationship with China through the Office of Terrorism Financing and the interagency process for CFIUS and other export control decisions. Do you agree to commit to work with me as the Treasury Department moves forward on the export control decisions, the foreign investment, and modernizing our anti-money laundering bank secrecy provisions, as well as beneficial ownership rules?
Senator, you have my pledge that I'll work closely with you on these very important matters, and I want to thank you and Congress for passing a law that will enable us to identify beneficial ownership of shell corporations and really make a big difference in our ability to address terrorist financing and improve the effectiveness of sanctions.
Thank you. I appreciate your attention to this. Senator Stabenow is next. I believe she's remote.
Well, good morning. And first, I want to say thank you to Senator Crapo, to you. Congratulations in your incoming position, and also to Senator Wyden, Senator Grassley. I think we're off to a great start in the committee doing this in a bipartisan way, and I look forward to a lot more opportunities. And also, Madam Chair, I have to tell you, as I've indicated you before, I was extremely excited to hear of your nomination. I can't think of anyone with more competence, more experience, more integrity to serve as Secretary of the Treasury. And it's just extra special that you come in as the first woman to do so. So congratulations.
Thank you so much, Stephanie.
You're welcome. Let me first say that I don't believe we have an economy unless somebody makes something and somebody grows something. That's what we do in Michigan. We do both. But I want to talk about the making part of it now, as we talked before, and how we have to make more of it in America. And I think Michigan certainly is part of leading the way. And to tackle the big issue around the climate crisis, as well as global leadership in manufacturing and so on, certainly electrifying our vehicles fleet is a very important part of that. So just to refresh, we are the US auto industry accounts for about 3.5% of our domestic gross domestic product. And for us in the United States, GM is investing heavily in electric vehicles, some $27 billion to bring 30 different EVs to the marketplace in the next 4 years. Very aggressive. Ford doing the same kind of thing. And excuse me here, I'm getting up. There we go. Ford doing the same with $11.5 billion, including their electrifying of their F-150 truck. So there's a very, very exciting things happening. Same with FCA with their popular Jeep line. All good news that we are doing that. However, when we talk about China, it's not just stealing our patents and currency manipulation and other things that I have deep concerns about. But what we are seeing is that over the last decade, the Chinese government has invested $100 billion in EV industry. And what is very concerning is that of the 142 lithium ion mega factories under construction, out of 142, 107 of them are in China, and only 9 of them are in the United States. So it's no surprise that by 2025, 54% of the EV sales are projected to occur in China. So we've got to get ahead of this. I know, looking at the Build Back Better plan and our president-elect, I know that he cares and you care about this as well. But I wonder if you could speak for a moment on what we need to do, particularly around the consumer incentives. Until we get enough people purchasing, these consumer incentives are critical. Senator Alexander and I had a bipartisan bill to extend the current consumer credit. This needs to get done this year. And Senator Schumer, I'm working with him on a broader package that's very important to take us the next step in electric vehicles. But I wonder if you might talk about what we need to do, and do you support the consumer credits that we need to create the market for purchasing EVs?
Thank you for that question, Senator. Climate change is a critical problem facing the country, and President-elect Biden is committed to a wide range of policies to address it, and in the process, making sure that in doing that, we create good jobs for American workers. As you've suggested, it's important that we make things in America. And electric vehicles are a very important way of both creating good jobs and addressing climate change. The president-elect is supportive of restoring full incentives for electric vehicles. He wants to ensure a robust electric vehicle market. And on top of that, that will involve building infrastructure and making sure that our workers have the skills that are needed to succeed in electric vehicles.
Thank you. Along with that, we know that a lot of the jobs in electric vehicles now are the component parts. They are mid-sized employers, the auto suppliers, the supply chain, so critical right now. And we're making these new component parts, and our auto suppliers are very excited to do that. But I'm concerned that with what has happened under COVID, that the piece that just didn't happen as I believe it should, and despite Senator Mark Warner, who did such wonderful work that I supported and worked with our auto suppliers and how we deal with our mid-level businesses, we just, I believe, have not done fully what we need to do to support those jobs. Do you have any thoughts on where we need to go for our mid-level employers that employ about 50 million people in this country?
I think that you're absolutely right, Senator Stabenow, that the largest corporations that have access to capital markets have not had trouble raising money. We have a heavy focus on small businesses trying to get them the aid they need, and mid-sized businesses have had problems. The Main Street lending program the Fed set up was not very effective at reaching them. And so that's an important area for us to focus on, making sure that capital is available for those businesses so that they can continue to create jobs and thrive in our economy.
Thank you. Senator Stabenow.
I'm out of time. I would just, not a question, but just, Madam Chair, you and I have talked about the multi-employer pension crisis, deeply concerned about that and the over 1.3 million workers and families that are affected. So I look forward to talking with you more and developing a way to protect those middle-class Americans. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. And I've been notified by staff that those who are remote may not have the clock in front of them. So I'll try to remind those who are remote when their time runs out. Next is Senator Thune.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Yellen, welcome. Congratulations. I'm going to try and roll a lot of thoughts and questions into sort of one big package here. But the one thing that concerns me that nobody seemed to be talking about anymore is the massive amount of debt that we continue to rack up as a nation. And in fact, the president-elect has proposed a couple trillion-dollar fiscal plan on top of that which we've already done, which would add somewhere on the order of about $5.3 trillion to deficits, and that's according to the Committee for a Responsible Budget, of which you have been a board member. That's 25% of GDP, and it would move the additional debt above 100% debt to GDP, which are, it's categories that we haven't been in literally since the 1940s. And so what I'm concerned about is we seem to have no concern now about borrowing money in the short term. And the argument is that interest rates are low. It's like free money. It's not. It has to be paid back. And at some point, the risk-return ratio that people who are lending us money are going to say is not sufficient for the risk, and we're going to demand a higher interest rate. That'll happen at some point. Interest rates will start to normalize, and we have to refinance at a higher interest rate. And pretty soon, the interest on the debt exceeds what we spend on even national security for our country. Republicans traditionally have believed that we ought to reduce spending, we need to reform entitlement programs, that we need to have policies in place that create greater growth in the economy, all of which make the debt look smaller by comparison. Democrats have argued we need more revenue, more taxes, and Senator Crapo also already sort of got at that issue. But I just want to know what you think, because I know in the past you've expressed concerns about the debt and the deficit. The two previous administrations have not been very interested in entitlement reform. We have not only the debt that we're adding in the short term because of the pandemic, but we have structural problems that are long term that are going to drive that, continue to drive that debt higher in the future. What your thoughts are with respect to reforming entitlements, with respect to the amount of the debt situation that we find ourselves right now, and when is it enough? When is it too much? When do we hit that point where the thing starts to collapse? That's what really concerns me, and nobody is talking about it. really in either party anymore. It was something that used to occupy a lot of our discussions in the past, but nobody seems to care much about it. And for me, that is a huge warning sign on the horizon, the fact that we have an ever-growing deficit, an ever-growing debt, and no apparent interest in taking the steps that are necessary to address it.
Senator, I agree with you that it's essential that we put the federal budget on a path that's sustainable, and that we're responsible and make sure that what we do with respect to deficits and debt leave future generations better off. But the most important thing, in my view, that we can do today to put us on a path of fiscal sustainability is to defeat the pandemic, to provide relief to American people, and then to make long-term investments that will help the economy grow and benefit future generations. To avoid doing what we need to do now to address the pandemic and the economic damage that it's causing would likely leave us in a worse place fiscally and with respect to our debt situation than taking the steps that are necessary and doing that through deficit finance. We really have to worry about scarring due to this pandemic of workers and the loss of small businesses that can really harm the long-run potential productivity of our economy and leave us with long-run problems that would make it difficult to get back on the growth path that we were on. And it's really critically important to provide this relief now. And I believe it would be a false economy to stint. But over the longer term, I would agree with you that the long-term fiscal trajectory is a cause for concern. It's something we will eventually need to attend to, but it's also important for America to invest and invest in our infrastructure, invest in our workers, invest in R&D, the things that make our economy grow faster and make it more competitive. And it's important to remember that we're in a very low interest rate environment. And that's something that existed before the pandemic hit. Interest rates were low even before the financial crisis of 2008. This has been a trend in developed economies. You can see it across the developed world, and it represents structural shifts that are likely to be with us a long time. So although the debt to GDP ratio has increased, it's important to note that the interest burden of the debt, interest as a share of GDP, is no higher now than it was before the financial crisis in 2008, in spite of the fact that our debt has escalated. And of course, interest rates can increase. Eventually, we have to make sure that primary deficits in the budget are sufficiently small, that we're on a sustainable path. But right now, our challenge is to get America back to work and to defeat the pandemic.
Thank you. Senator Cantwell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I, too, want to congratulate the nominee. I want to thank President-elect Biden for nominating a woman and Dr. Yellen for your willingness to serve. I can already see by the words that you've chosen, women, workers, workforce, workforce training, that you are likely to deliver economic policies that are more focused on Main Street than Wall Street. And I hope that is what I'm hearing, because I believe that we need wage growth in America, that Americans from all walks of life need more aspects to wage growth. And I hope the policies of the Biden administration and you will help deliver that. I have four areas that I'd like to quickly go over if I could. that are important to these policies. First, I want to make sure that you are going to protect federal taxpayers and their investments as far as the private banking that exists in America, and that you will protect, continue to enforce the important laws that are on the books and use the Federal Stability Oversight Committee to make sure that we're protecting depositors from having the federal government, again, ever having to bail out Wall Street, and to make sure that we're focusing on Main Street instead.
Senator Cantwell, I couldn't agree with you more. Our focus should be on Main Street, not Wall Street. And we should demand, as Dodd-Frank insisted, that the largest institutions, particularly those that pose systemic risks, have adequate capital and liquidity and plans by which, if they were to fail, they could be resolved without posing burdens on taxpayers. During my time at the Fed, I worked very hard to strengthen the banking system to make sure that these institutions don't operate in ways that would harm Main Street. And I am pleased to see that when the pandemic hit and there was a good deal of financial disruption, that especially the largest banks have been able to, due to the reforms that were put in place, continue to lend, to survive with adequate capital and to support the needs of households and businesses. And you have my absolute pledge that this will continue to be my focus.
Thank you. Thank you. I have to jump to the next one because it's very important. I have an economy that's 1 in 4 jobs are related to trade. Not been a fan of the Trump administration's what I would call unilateral protectionism. I don't think that this is the direction in an economy where 95% of consumers live outside the United States of America. We have digital trade issues that need to be resolved. We have national security issues that need to be resolved. So a recent Oxford Economics trade war study said that the Trump administration's trade war cost us 245,000 American jobs. And the Federal Reserve Bank of New York and Columbia University found that U.S. companies lost $1.7 trillion in the price of their stocks as a result of U.S. tariffs imposed on trade wars. So I'm asking you, do you repudiate basically unilateral protectionism?
Senator, I believe we should try to address unfair trade practices. And the best way to do that is to work with our allies rather than unilaterally. And when the unfair practices have to do with things like stealing intellectual property and engaging in forced technology transfer or subsidies that provide an unfair technological advantage, I think we should focus directly on those practices and work with our allies to make sure that they're addressed.
Well, we in the Pacific Northwest believe in an export economy. And so we want an export economy to take place, so you have to have trade. And so we want to continue to focus on that. I do believe in using sanctions, though, and I think the Trump administration failed to be as aggressive on sanctions. So I want to make sure that you will use that as an economic tool, particularly as it relates to cyber attacks on our infrastructure. In the last few weeks, there have been so many momentous occasions. I think we've lost sight of the incredible impact of what happened with the hacking on our information system. And I want to know that you will use sanctions when necessary on people who have attacked our infrastructure.
Sanctions are a critically important tool to address cybersecurity and other threats. And you can be sure that I will be focused on making sure that they're used strategically and appropriately. And I intend to ask my deputy, if he's confirmed, Wally Adeyemo, to quickly begin a review of our sanctions policy to make sure we're doing this in a strategic way and in the most effective way we can.
Thank you. And I look forward to working with you on increasing affordable housing tax credits. My colleague, Senator Young, and I continue to, we know you know and you understand how much affordable housing is important to our country and economy. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. And I agree with you on that as well. Next is Senator Menendez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Dr. Yellen, congratulations on your nomination. Look forward to supporting you. I know that Senator Grassley asked you a question on SALT, and you said you're going to study it. I hope when you study it, you look at the fact that there are states like New Jersey who give billions more than we get back, and states like Iowa that get $5 billion more than they pay in federal taxes, or Kentucky that gets $111 billion more than it pays in federal taxes, or Florida that gets $60 billion more than it pays in federal taxes. So you can't have states continue to be economic engines and then also be hurt, in this case, by the property tax deduction. So it should be a total look at the total equation, and I hope you will do that as part of your review.
To do that.
Now, since 2020 of the last year, state and local governments have laid off 1.3 million workers. That's 1.3 million doctors and nurses and teachers and school custodians, 1.3 million essential workers we rely on to fight for us on the front lines of the battle on COVID. It's economic malpractice from my perspective, what is happening. Could you explain some of the lessons that were learned from the 2008 Great Recession and the consequences of Congress failing to adequately address the fiscal crisis facing state and local governments that are causing these and other impending layoffs?
Well, as you know, in 2008, when the economy suffered such a serious downturn, state and local governments saw a huge shortfall in revenue and increased need to spend on safety net type programs, and they faced massive deficits. And although Congress and the administration passed the American Recovery and Reform Act and spent at the federal level, there was a huge offset just from the total economic point of view that came about because state and local governments have to balance their budgets, and they were forced to slash their workforces. And the same thing as you just described is happening now.
And it's fair to say that was a drag on the economy, is it not?
It was a tremendous drag on the economy, and the same would be true now. And as you mentioned, we are seeing layoffs, especially of teachers, but prospectively of policemen and firefighters and other essential workers.
So it wouldn't be a good time to withhold fiscal support from state and local governments?
Not in my view.
Right. Now, you stated that the economic fallout of the pandemic is, quote, an American tragedy. And I agree. What makes it uniquely an American tragedy is that minority communities, and as the longest serving Latino in Congress, I can tell you that community, African-Americans and other minority communities, have borne the disproportionate brunt of the COVID-related economic fallout. In December, nearly 10% of African-American workers, 9.3% of Latino workers were unemployed, compared to 6% of the other population. 28% of Black renters and 24% of Latino renters were not caught up on their rent, compared to 12% of white renters. 55% of African-American adults and 51% of Latino adults reported difficulty in covering their expenses, compared to 31% for white Americans. That's a very dark and dire picture. If confirmed, you'll be in a position to promote policies to reduce racial inequality, especially as we continue to fight the COVID-19 pandemic. Can you give me a sense of how you plan to ensure that our response to the economic crisis will also help the minority communities that are being disproportionately hurt?
Senator, you cited some dramatic and disturbing statistics, And they're absolutely right. This pandemic is taking just an unbelievable toll on low-income workers and on minorities, especially. And because I am so concerned about the impact on minority communities, the very first meeting that I had after my nomination was announced was with representatives of racial justice and equity groups to hear from them what their needs are. And I promise you that I will be fully focused on putting into place at every level relief for these communities. An example would be the State Small Business Credit Initiative that is contained in President-elect Biden's package announced last week. There's money there to capitalize lending to small businesses and a proposal to provide grants to loans for small entrepreneurs. And of course, with respect to food security, evictions, unemployment insurance, and relief that these households need, paid leave, the minimum wage, all of these things, I believe, will be very beneficial.
Thank you. My time has expired, but I just want to say, I hope as part of that, I like a lot what you said. I hope you also diversify the Treasury Department, which really needs to have voices at the table to help you meet those challenges.
I completely agree with you, Senator.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Senator Toomey. Is Senator Toomey online? I'm told that he is not, so we will move on. Senator Carper. Yeah. I'm told you're here, Senator Carper. Oh, excuse me. All right, we'll go on to Senator Scott.
Good morning.
I hear you. Go ahead, Senator Scott.
Excellent. Can you hear me fine?
I can hear you. Yeah, now we can see you also. Go ahead.
Oh, excellent. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you. I want to continue to call you Chair Yellen, though it's Dr. Yellen, and it's so good to see you again. And thank you for your willingness to serve during these challenging times without question. I'll hop right to it because Chairman Crable will keep me to my 5 minutes. The first question I have is about the pandemic relief package that's been presented. You know, as well as I do, that in December we passed a package that included $80 billion for schools to reopen, $280 billion to restart the Paycheck Protection Program for a second round. It also included billions of dollars for the vaccines, which I think is certainly an area where we need to invest even more than we have so far, without question. But the $1.9 trillion package that has been presented to us is a package that focuses on some priorities that I think will actually hurt our economy as much as it would improve our economy. One in particular is the issue of raising the minimum wage to $15 an hour. I will say that I've been talking to businesses around the country and specifically at home. The one thing that even the Congressional Budget Office recognizes is that by increasing the minimum wage to $15 an hour, it could shutter somewhere around 3.7 million jobs on the high end, a minimum of 1.3 million jobs in our economy. And the last thing this economy needs as we attempt to recover is a loss of 1.3 to 3.7 million jobs. But in addition to that, it would increase the cost of doing business significantly. It would certainly devastate the opportunity to develop new jobs in rural America and in rural South Carolina, as well as for those minorities and women coming into the workforce. It would actually have a disproportionate impact on those folks that you said in your testimony you want to target for relief and opportunity. Said differently, over 110,000 restaurants have closed during the pandemic, thousands of those restaurants in South Carolina. By increasing the minimum wage to $15 an hour and eliminating tips for servers at restaurants, we will do actually what I would consider an existential threat to those restaurants and, frankly, and more importantly, to those employees of restaurants. How do we grapple with parts of this package that really are philosophical in nature and denies the practical reality that comes from it?
Well, Senator, I appreciate that question. You know, President-elect Biden and has proposed raising the minimum wage to $15 an hour because right now we have millions of American workers who are putting their lives on the line to keep their communities functioning, and sometimes even working multiple jobs aren't earning enough to put food on the table and a roof over their heads. And they're suffering in countless ways, especially during this pandemic, and really struggling to get by. And raising the minimum wage would really help many of those workers. And that's the reason for doing it. Now, in terms of potential job loss, there's now a large economics literature on this, and much of it suggests that the raising minimum wages, this is what researchers often look at, what happens when one state raises its minimum wage and a neighboring state leaves it alone, to see how businesses fare in the two different places with different treatments. And the findings are that the job loss is very minimal, if anything. So I think that the likely impact on jobs is minimal. That's my reading of the research. And of course, I agree with you, small businesses are struggling, and it's critical to help those businesses. Appreciate the people recently passed that we will do to get the struggling. It is to help those businesses. The money that's been allocated to CDFIs, especially moderate income, that's critically important aid. And President-elect Biden has proposed yet more aid to these businesses so that they can survive this pandemic and get back on their feet.
Well, thank you for your answer, Dr. Yellen. I would say that there's no doubt that when you artificially increase the minimum wage, you are going to permanently decrease the number of jobs in the economy. When we have a market-driven increase in the minimum wage, we see production go up and the value of work increases as well. My final question in my have left.
Any. Actually, you're.
Yes, just say this for the record. Well, enough being enough, to make sure that for us to save some of the resources for the next time we need to respond to a global crisis of some sort. Thank you, Dr. Yellen. And I look have that answer just in writing, ma'am. Have a great day.
Thank you, Senator Scott. Senator Toomey.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Thank you. And Dr. Yellen, welcome for your country.
I think you nailed it. I like to say the main thing is to keep the main thing the main thing. And the main thing to an economic recovery is to reel in this pandemic. The best way to do that is we're getting new vaccines, vaccines almost by the month now. Vaccinate the heck out of our country in ways that people will find welcome.
I completely agree with you, and I think that that is a top priority. And then I would say another principle that's really critical is that we have to relieve the suffering that this pandemic has caused.
How do we target that? Maybe a little bit better or differently than is proposed in this relief package from the administration, incoming administration. How do we target it better?
Yeah, I mean, you know, we need to look at how to target it. It needs to go to the businesses that are most at risk, small businesses, particularly businesses in low and moderate income areas that receive less than a proportionate share of PPP relief in the first round of PPP aid. So we need to target small business relief at those most vulnerable businesses. We need to make sure that people aren't going hungry in America, that they can put food on the table, that they're not losing their homes and ending up out on the street because of evictions. We really need to address those forms of suffering, and I think we shouldn't compromise on it. And if we don't do so, that suffering and the loss of spending it will cause other people to lose jobs and permanent scarring that will harm the economy over the longer term.
Right, thanks. Thank you for that. We have, as you know, millions of people who lost their jobs. In many cases, employers are out of business. And the folks that have lost their jobs don't have the skills to be able to do the jobs that are out there being going untaken. We've heard some ideas of late how to address that. And one is to use our community college systems across the country to provide not the ability to get a two-year degree, but the ability to get, in some cases, just train your certificate for a job that needs to be done. Would you think out loud about that?
I'm strongly supportive of supporting the community college system. I think it provides a wide range of very valuable training, in some cases helping people to go on to college, but in many cases, providing training, as you indicated, to workers who've lost their jobs, who need new skills and new credential to be able to move into jobs that are available in expanding sectors. And I think investing in that system, making sure it's available to anybody who needs it and can benefit from it is really important.
Thanks so much. Mr. Chairman, I may have used up my time.
Yes, you have.
Mention a question for the record, and then I'll stop, if I could, please.
Go ahead.
Dr. I'm going to ask you a question for the record. Ask you to share your thoughts with us on the need for measures such as temporary refundability of clean energy tax credits that can help the clean energy industry secure project financing and get back on its feet. I'll ask you that question for the record, but I just wanted to flag it here. Thanks for your extraordinary service. It's great to be with you as always. Thanks, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator.
Thank you. Senator Cardin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Dr. Yellen, thank you very much for your long commitment to public service and your willingness to take on this challenge. And we thank your family also, because we know it's going to be a family sacrifice. I'm sure your discussions at your dinner table will be very interesting. Let me follow up on Senator Cantwell's question as it relates to sanctions. You indicate that you're going to have a review of the use of sanctions, and absolutely on cyber attack. But we're also suffering today in decline of democracy. Human Rights Watch said the last 4 years were a disaster for human rights. American values have been under attack. We have a decline in the number of democratic states in the nation, in the world. So Congress has passed sanction regimes in order to deal with strengthening democratic states. And we've done that on specific issues. We've done it on the Global Magnitsky Statute. And I just really want to encourage you, as you're reviewing the use of sanctions, to recognize that we have real challenges today, and the United States has to exercise its leadership. Senator Young and I have introduced legislation to deal with corruption. Corruption is one of the most corrosive elements in the decline of democratic states. And we're suggesting using a tier system on how countries are dealing with corruption, similar to what we do on human trafficking, with consequences. So my first question is your willingness to work with us in Congress so that we can be united in the use of sanctions globally to advance U.S. values.
You have my pledge, Senator Cardin. I look forward to working with you. These are very important challenges and goals. Sanctions are a tool that can be very effective, and pledge to work with you on implementing them in a way that does address these abuses.
Thank you. My second point is an area that has been mentioned by many members, including yourself in your opening statement, and that is dealing with our minority community, the underbanked community, the underserved community as we come out of COVID-19. I have the honor of being a lead Democrat on the Small Business Committee and worked with Senator Rubio on developing a lot of the tools that were in the first two major COVID relief packages. And we learned a lot from that. And it's difficult to get to the underserved communities. And we really do need to concentrate and find better ways to dealing with it. We did learn that small businesses that are stressed much prefer a grant than a loan, even a forgivable loan, because they really don't want to put another loan on their books. So we've looked at ways to develop grants that are targeted to the most vulnerable small businesses. We know that they need resource partners so that they are not last in line, but first in line in order to be able to get help. We know that there is very limited amount of venture capital, particularly in emerging markets, for minority small businesses. And we certainly know the smaller the small businesses are the more vulnerable ones. So my plea to you is, as you are developing these packages, please work with us on what we found has worked and what has not worked, so we can really help the most vulnerable of our small businesses, our most vulnerable of our communities, as we look for tools to help those communities that are targeted to provide the relief to communities that have been left out for way too long.
Senator, I pledge to work with you closely on that. This is a very high priority objective of President-elect Biden. The proposal that he put forward last Thursday does contain funding for additional grants to these very hard hit businesses, and also funds a small business opportunity fund that would be able to be leveraged, enable various state and nonprofit programs to leverage a large volume of lending to businesses that have been hard hit and that have opportunities. But we will look for ways to target it and work with you closely to understand what's best.
I thank you for that. And my last question deals with the lack of retirement security for Americans. Before COVID-19, we were not doing what we needed to do. As a result of COVID-19, more and more households are not saving anything for retirement today. We've passed some legislation in the past, the SECURE Act. I've worked with Senator Portman on bipartisan legislation. We're working on bipartisan legislation in this Congress. I would just urge you to be an active partner with us on how we can increase retirement security options for workers in this country.
I completely agree with the priority that you place on this, Senator Cardin. It's really so many families are not prepared for retirement, haven't been able to save for it. It's a huge problem, and the pandemic is making it worse as hard-hit families are running down their saving. I think in this economy, everyone needs access to a workplace retirement saving plan, and look forward to working with you to address this issue.
Thank you very much. Thank you. And thank you for your willingness to serve.
Thank you.
Thank you. Senator Cassidy.
Hey, Dr. Yellen, nice to see you again. And again, thank you for our conversation before. You used the word targeted multiple times in your response to Senator Cardin. Senator Carper suggested that perhaps the Biden plan could be a little bit more targeted. The extra $1,400 to families, some of whom are working, they've seen no decrease in their income, many of whom actually, analysis from the first check that went up to $1,200 showed that for many it turned out to be discretionary income, or they put it in savings, and there's some reports that there was more money invested in the stock market. So do you, since you mentioned targeted, would you view this additional $1,400 stimulus check as a targeted relief?
Well, I believe that in the president-elect's proposal, it would go to individuals earning $75,000, or less, or couples earning less than $150,000 or less. Some families presumably don't greatly need the money, but there are many families who were under stress, who people have had to drop out of the labor force, aren't receiving unemployment.
Can I ask them that? Not to be, I only have 5 minutes. So, but on the other hand, the unemployment insurance that is going out there would be a very directed relief for those who've had to drop out of the workforce. Totally accept that. So, but it seems like the $1,400 on top of the unemployment and on top of some of the other, you know, the rent relief, for example, seems to be less targeted. And I go back there because targeted keeps on coming up.
Well, it is less targeted, but there are many families that are bearing exceptional financial burdens that are not addressed by unemployment compensation. People who've had to drop out of the labor force because their children are out of school, who simply can't participate because they need to take care of family priorities.
Can I interrupt again, just because I don't mean to be rude, I only have 5 minutes and I only have 2.5. There's also money for education. And I'll note that in the COVID relief package just passed, plus the CARES package, I think we put in a net of $66 billion for education. The total federal outlay is typically only $57 billion. So we've actually over 100% of what the schools already get. Again, if we're looking at what is targeted, although I'm sure there's always somebody who has need, it seems as if that need would have been met with over 100% increased subsidy to those schools. I'll just mention that. Let me ask you a couple more things. The previous administration considered issuing 50-year bonds to take care, to take advantage of the low interest rates and to retire some of the shorter term bonds. Is that something that you would consider? Because I think they decided against, but I'm just wondering what your appetite would be, what you think just this administration's appetite would be for that.
Well, there is an advantage to funding the debt, especially when interest rates are very low, by issuing long-term debt. And I would be very pleased to take a look at this issue, examine what the market would be like for bonds of that maturity, and interested in hearing your thoughts on this issue and working with you on that.
Then let me also ask about infrastructure, because that may involve borrowing. And infrastructure, clearly the problem with the big package has been, how do we finance? Now, if we spend roughly $450 billion on increased stimulus checks, well, you know, intuitively, that's going to take away some of the appetite for more deficit spending for an infrastructure package. But obviously, putting Americans back to work with an infrastructure program would be very beneficial for Americans. I'll just say that editorially, it does seem as if there's only going to be a certain limit for borrowing if we don't have a source of revenue to pay for it. Let me go back to the infrastructure. What thoughts do you have on infrastructure? And is this one of the programs that you think the Biden administration would be considering not raising revenue for, but rather just borrowing in order to pay for, to get the economic benefit?
Well, I think that's, so let me just say that President-elect Biden has proposed an ambitious Build Back Better program that involves infrastructure, infrastructure. It involves clean energy, investing in manufacturing, R&D, training. We've yet to decide exactly how that should be financed. Remember that companies often borrow to invest in projects that have sufficiently high returns that there is a net benefit. And there are at least some investment programs for the public sector that have been shown to have extremely high returns, where I think one could argue for borrowing to finance them. But that's something we will have to look at carefully, the financing of those programs.
Thank you very much. I yield back. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Cassidy. And to all of the senators, we have a limited time available in this room. We still have time to get through all the questions, but I'm going to ask all the members to please pay very close attention to the clock. With that, we go next to Senator Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Yell, welcome. I'm looking forward to working with you to make the World War II level investment we need to defeat the pandemic and build a better economy that honors the dignity of all work. Last week, on the way out the door, the current Treasury Secretary rushed through an agreement with the Federal Housing Finance Agency that locks in big changes to the GSEs, leaving you to deal with consequences. In the Banking and Housing Committee, I've laid out a path for reforming our housing finance system. I look forward to working with you on these principles and on implementing the $25 billion emergency rental assistance program we passed last month. We also need to make sure that IRS is enforcing our tax code in a fair way. I want to work with you to make sure IRS's auditing and enforcement activities don't have disparate impacts for Black and Brown communities, as soon-to-be Chair Wyden has brought up also. Another critical issue is fixing the multi-employer pension crisis. There are over 1 million Americans relying on us to save the pension that they've already earned. I'm glad Senator Stabenow raised that earlier. I look forward to working with her and with you to address this problem, which gets worse by the month. Many of us also were excited that the president-elect included an expansion of the Earned Income Child Tax Credit and the Child Tax Credit in the Rescue Plan, especially the refundability of it. That's going to make a huge difference in the lives of so many families. I thank my colleague, Senator Bennett, for his partnership on this. For the first time ever, and we've talked about this, we can give families the option to put their CTC checks, to get their CTC checks monthly. That's what my Working Family Tax Relief Act calls for. If we combine that with a plan to give every American access to a no-fee checking account at a community bank, a credit union, or the post office, we can give millions of families the security of a steady financial boost and give them more power over their lives. They won't have to worry about a predatory financial institution charging them exorbitant fees just to use their own money. So I have two quick yes or no questions. If we make monthly distribution an option for families, will you ensure that IRS makes every effort to implement it as fast as possible?
Yes, I will. I'll need to consult with IRS, but I'll try to get it implemented as rapidly as possible.
And Madam Chair, if the IRS needs additional funding to make this happen, will you make sure the president-elect's budget proposal includes the funding IRS will need?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Turning now to the impact, following up on Senator Menendez, on state and local governments, how that affects millions of workers. My state faces a $2.4 billion budget gap. My state, all states, need help to prevent layoffs of teachers and firefighters and sanitation workers and children's service workers. I'm glad President-elect Biden understands that, is calling for that $350 billion in new aid. Just if you would expand a bit briefly, what are the costs if our country fails to make this investment in local and state governments?
Well, we're already seeing substantial layoffs of teachers, and with budget shortfalls, we're going to see further layoffs of essential workers, including policemen and firefighters and sanitation workers. And not only is this going to be a further hardship for these essential workers in the communities that they serve, but it's also going to have ripple effects through the economy as they contract their spending and create further job losses throughout the economy. I think it's very important that we provide this aid. It's also critical to get children back to school. State and local governments and their school systems need the resources to reopen schools. It's President-elect Biden's plan to try to have that happen within the next 100 days, but the schools need more resources that state and local governments would be hard-pressed to provide.
Thank you, Madam Chair. A number of my colleagues have talked today about competitiveness. It's clear from your comments you understand that investing, that corporations paying their fair share in reforming our tax code so it puts workers first, American jobs first, actually helps American competitiveness. Investing in workers through the dignity of work helps us be more competitive. Ms. Chairman, I'll just close with this, that I wanted to talk for a moment about the work that you and I did in the Banking Housing Committee. I appreciate Chair Yellen's comments today in the New York Times about restoring FSOC to its intended role. I look forward to working with the chair and with Ranking Member Toomey on that. Climate change, creating clean energy jobs, implementing, as you and I have talked, Madam Chair, implementing our anti-money laundering bill. We're losing billions of tax dollars to these anonymous overseas shell corporations, revenue that could be used to do a lot of the things that we've talked about today. So I'm thrilled that you're returning to public service. And Mr. Chair, I thank you for your forbearance.
Thank you, Senator Brown.
Thank you so much,
Senator Lankford.
Thank you. Dr. Yellen, thanks again for stepping back into government service. It is not an easy thing for anyone to be able to step in and do, especially in this season. So thanks for stepping back in again to be able to do that. Let me ask you a whole multitude of questions, and I'll try to be rapid and to be able to walk through some of these. You made a comment to Senator Thune earlier saying eventually we're going to have to deal with the issue of debt. What is kind of the warning sign that you look for? And is there an upper limit to the federal debt that we should be watching for? And in your perspective, what are the key signs? Because if you use the word eventually, that would tell me that you don't think it's infinite. What is that upper limit?
Oh, well, I would agree with you. I think there's no single metric that summarizes our overall fiscal situation. But one metric that I do think is useful to keep in mind is the interest burden of the debt. What share of our economy of GDP is going to pay interest on the debt? The higher that gets, the more we find we have to use tax revenue just to pay the interest on the debt. And eventually that can lead to having to curtail other services, other spending, or eventually lead to runaway debt accumulation that would be an unsustainable path. In a very low interest rate environment like we're in, what we're seeing is that even though the amount of debt relative to the economy has gone up, the interest burden hasn't. So I would keep the interest burden in mind as a metric. Right now it's low, but longer term, we have to make sure that deficits that we run in the federal budget are consistent with stability in that kind of ratio.
I would submit that we have to find an earlier warning sign, because once interest rates start ticking up, in some ways it's too late because you have so much debt that's there and the interest rates begin to tick up. If you find that moment where it's unsustainable, it rapidly gets worse. You made a comment in an interview in 2018 that I want to be able to follow up with you on it. In this particular interview, you said the United States debt path was unsustainable, and that if I had a magic wand, I would raise taxes and cut retirement spending. Do you remember what you meant by that? It was a comment that you made in 2018, and I'm not playing quiz show with you to try to go back and to be able to review that, but I want to know just your perspective in 2018. If you had a magic wand because of unsustainable debt path, I would raise taxes and cut retirement spending.
Well, we've long known that as our population ages, and if medical expenses, healthcare costs continue to rise over time at rates faster than the general level of other prices, that there would be increasing shortfalls in both Social Security and Medicare, and that eventually we would need to find ways to address it. And it doesn't have to be, these are very important programs. I think it's important to remember that once upon a time, poverty in the United States, if you looked at who the poor population was, it was the elderly. And these programs have played an essential role in giving Americans a safe and secure and dignified retirement. So we need to preserve these programs and certainly preserve the benefits, especially for lower income Americans who depend on them.
You're not discouraging retirement savings or tax incentives for individuals that choose to retirement.
I think we should also have incentives and ways to help people save for retirement above and beyond that. But I would want to see these benefits preserved. One thing that we could do to diminish imbalances is to find ways to deliver health care more cheaply and more efficiently. And there are a lot of ideas for doing that. And I would look first to those kinds of things to achieve sustainability.
Okay, so really what you meant by that wasn't cut retirement spending, it was cut the amount that retirees spend on healthcare. Is that what you're saying?
Well, that would be an important way to find ways to deliver these healthcare services more efficiently.
Thank you. I will have several questions for the follow-up on the record about the role of OCC. Obviously, that's a different role that's there. You mentioned before about raising taxes, not right now. It'd be hard to be able to do that right now. I want to get a feel from you on what those initial metrics are you're looking for before we can raise taxes to be able to deal with that, and also sanctions issues with Iran and how that specifically plays into the coming decisions you'll have to make. So I'll submit those for the record. I appreciate your testimony.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Lankford. I appreciate the senators paying attention to the clock. Senator Bennett.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's good to see you. And thanks, Dr. Yellen, for your willingness to serve. I think we're very, very lucky that you're willing to do it, especially at this time. And I want to say one word to my colleagues. I've heard the discussion today about deficit, and I share the view that in the long term, we need to figure out how to create a sustainable fiscal path for our country. I share that view. I also believe that we've made some poor choices in terms of what we've borrowed money to spend on. We had two wars in the Middle East that lasted for 20 years that cost us something like $5.6 trillion, all of which was borrowed, none of which was paid for. We've cut taxes for $5 trillion, almost all of it to the wealthiest people in America, and we borrowed every penny to do that. And as Dr. Yellen was just saying, we're running, and I don't think anybody can take pride in this, a healthcare system in America that costs twice as much as any other healthcare system in the world, and we're borrowing a whole bunch of money to do that. What we haven't done is invested in our human capital, our people. What we haven't done is invest in our infrastructure. It's not in America, in the next generation of Americans. So it's not just a matter of what the balance sheet looks like. It's also a question of what are the choices that we're making. And I hope together we're going to make some choices with this new administration to invest in the American people and give them a fighting chance in this terrible pandemic and in this slowing economy. And it brings me to my question for you, Dr. Yellen. It's a little odd because you can't actually see you, but I wanted to talk about the decision that the Biden administration made to include the expanded child tax credit and to make it fully refundable, to take it up from the level that it is today to $3,000. Sherrod Brown, my colleague from Ohio, and I have been working on that for almost a decade. If this manages to make it through the Congress, we will have cut childhood poverty in America by 45%. By some estimates, the cost of childhood poverty in this country is $1 trillion. You were mentioning a minute ago in your answer to the Senator from Oklahoma the importance of programs like Medicare and in ending the childhood or the poverty we see among seniors or diminishing it. We have a crisis in our country because so many of our children are growing up in poverty. It would seem to me that of all the things we've talked about today, at least from my perspective, I can't think of anything that would make a greater difference in the prospects of the next generation and of this country's prospects than cutting childhood poverty almost in half in the way that you have proposed in the Biden recovery package. I wonder, Dr. Yellen, if you could say a word or two about the importance of that proposal.
Well, Senator Bennett, I very much agree with all of the points that you just made, that childhood poverty is way too high in America. And one of the best ways that we can reduce that is providing refundable child tax credit at a level that really makes a dent in that. And I think that this proposal is really important because, as you said, it will substantially reduce childhood poverty, give families the ability to invest in their children and to give them the kinds of tools that they need to succeed in this economy.
You know, one of the things we suggested in our bill, I think Senator Brown talked a little bit about this, was the idea that the Treasury Secretary could set up monthly advanced child tax credit payments. I wonder, just in the last seconds that I have, whether you agree that monthly payments would aid in smoothing families' incomes and spending levels over the course of the year, better helping them make ends meet during this difficult time.
I agree. These families have serious liquidity issues, and not having to wait until tax day to receive these payments would be very beneficial. So I would certainly explore with the IRS what if it's possible to make these available in advance on a monthly basis.
Great. Well, we look forward to working with you on that. I'm out of time, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator. Senator Daines.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And thank you, Dr. Yellen, for being here today. I look forward to meeting with you one-on-one later this week as well. Before the pandemic, we had a booming economy. The national unemployment rate was 3.5%, lowest level we've seen in 50 years. Wages were growing for workers across the board. In fact, importantly, the wages for lower-income Americans were finally growing faster than those for high-income earners. And I believe this is due in no small part to the impact of the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act, which was signed into law in December of 2017. I am concerned by President-elect Biden's plans to increase taxes. I think that raising taxes in general is not a good idea, but particularly in the middle of a pandemic, it will be very harmful for growth. We think about Montana, in our state, 99% of our businesses are small businesses. And our small businesses, these mom-and-pop shops across our state, every corner, they've been hit hard by the pandemic. And this targeted relief has helped some, but the last thing we should be doing, in my opinion, is raising taxes. Not ever, in fact, but especially not during or after a pandemic. Dr. Yellen, I'd like to get your thoughts on this topic. Do you agree that raising taxes while the economy is still recovering from the pandemic is a bad idea?
Well, Senator, the focus right now is on providing relief and on helping families keep a roof over their head and food on the table and not on raising taxes. But longer term, I think it's important to the Biden program of Build Back Better, investing in people, investing in infrastructure, investing in research and development, in manufacturing, in things that will create good jobs and make our economy more productive. We need to think about taxes in the context of a package that aims to do those things. And to the extent that financing is required for these very valuable investments, I believe it should be come in a fair way. Taxes, collections relative to the economy have declined over time. And although the corporate tax cuts, I think, did improve the competitiveness of American businesses, and President-elect Biden is not proposing to raise the corporate tax to the level before that act, it's very important that corporations and wealthy individuals pay their fair share. And the proposals that he will make will be in the context of an overall package that's very beneficial to the economy. And I think working in the context of the OECD negotiations on global taxation, we have much greater leverage to keep our firms, American firms, competitive if we avoid a race to the bottom in corporate taxation globally. And that is one of the
Dr. Young, I know we'll have a chance to have probably vigorous and robust discussions about that, but I just want to remind everybody in this committee that it's the pass-throughs and the non-C-corps that are the primary drivers of economic growth in a state like Montana. It's smaller businesses, but we'll have that discussion at a later point. I want to shift gears about a bill I have with Senator Warren on the Retirement Savings Lost and Found Act. This really gets back to retirement policies to help Americans ensure that they are saving for their retirement. This bill recognizes that as people switch jobs, which Americans are doing at higher rates than ever before, many unknowingly leave behind employer-sponsored retirement savings accounts. This bill addresses the problem by requiring Treasury and Social Security to create a national lost and found registry using data employers are already required to report to the Treasury Department. Dr. Yellen, would you support this concept? It's a bill that I have with Senator Warren, and would you commit to working together to make sure this would be administered smoothly by the Treasury?
Absolutely. I think it's an important objective that you've outlined there. And if it does become law, of course, we will do everything possible to make sure that it's implemented effectively.
Okay. Dr. Yellen, I'm out of time. Thank you for your answers.
Thank you. Senator Casey.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Yellen, thanks for your to serve the American people again, and for
I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
Senator Casey, can you hear us?
I can hear you.
Oh, we can hear you again. Why don't you start again?
Okay. Oh, doctor, thanks so much. I hope you can hear me.
Now I can hear you.
Senator Casey, we can't hear you anymore. Can you hear us? I take it that we have a technical difficulty. When we can get Senator Casey back connected, we will return to him. Senator Whitehouse, I think, has had to step out.
No, I'm here.
Oh, good. Go ahead, Senator Whitehouse.
Okay, great. Bob, sorry to bump you. I hope your technology improves. Dr. Yellen, welcome back. Good to be with you. The American political system right now is rotten with dark money. Anonymous donors are all over our political system with huge contributions in what has been aptly described as a tsunami of slime flowing through our country. ProPublica has chronicled the inconsistent statements made by some of these groups between what they report to the IRS and what they report to election officials. Both statements are under oath, so when they're inconsistent, that raises a red flag. I just wanted to flag for you that when you are confirmed, I intend to ask you to direct a review of the IRS 501c policies, because it's my belief that for a long time, the policies of the IRS have been very misaligned with the statutory direction that Congress gave the IRS over these agencies, and that to a degree, the IRS was bullied into taking these non-statutory positions because there was so much blowback from the dark money forces and from their mouthpieces when they tried to intervene. I think the 501c problem and the extent to which anonymous money is now interfering in our politics is deadly serious. And I hope when I ask you, you'll take an honest look at this and not appoint someone to do it who'll give it a whitewash, and instead take a really good hard look at what went wrong.
Senator, I would be very glad to work with you on that. You're pointing to very disturbing situation, and I'll need to get up to speed on where things are with that, but I would be glad to initiate a serious review of this matter.
Good. Another serious matter is Freddie Mac warning of a coastal property values crash around the country because of climate change driven sea level rise. 40 sovereign banks warning of systemic global risk to the economic system from climate change. Economists warning of a carbon bubble that will clobber the US economy. And given how serious all of that is, I'm wondering where your senior level climate person will be in the Department of Treasury. There's no specific office. How are you gonna staff addressing climate at the most senior levels of Treasury?
Well, I will look to appoint someone at a very senior level to lead our efforts and to create a hub within Treasury in which we particularly focus on financial system related risks and tax policy incentives toward climate change. I think we need to seriously look at assessing the risks to the financial system from climate change. The Federal Reserve has recently said that they would be joining the network of supervisors for greening of the financial system. There are developing methodologies to do that, and we'll focus on that.
In a word or two, how seriously do you think we should take Freddie Mac's warnings of coastal property value crash, the sovereign bank warnings of systemic risk, and so many economists' warnings of a carbon bubble crash?
I think we should take these risks very, very seriously. I think climate change is an existential threat, and both the impact of climate change itself and policies to address it could have major impacts, creating stranded assets, generating large changes in asset prices, credit risks, and so forth that could affect the financial system. So these are very real risks.
And systemic risk is a mild phrase, but it conveys a very powerful message, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. I agree with you.
Last question. I believe that foreign corruption and kleptocracy is inimical to our national security interests. For too long, the U.S. has been a haven for international corruption and kleptocracy through our shell corporations. With intense leadership from Mike Crapo, who I want to give a big shout out to here, and Sherrod Brown, we got into the National Defense Bill, the Beneficial Ownership Reform, Incorporation Transparency Bill, another tedious name for something that's actually very brutal and essential. And I'm interested in who you think will lead the effort of cleaning up that mess using this new statute within Treasury, and how high up within Treasury will you place responsibility for cleaning up the dark money shell corporation problem that America has fomented?
So let me start by saying that this is a very important problem, and that the act that was recently passed by Congress gives us an enormously potent tool to address this problem. We will try to get up and running as quickly as possible and devote ourselves to building that database so that we can address these issues. And we'll be certainly looking to give this very high priority.
You agree it has a national security dimension?
Absolutely.
That's it for me. Thank you very much, Dr. Yellen. I really look forward to working with you, and to Bob Casey, my apologies for jumping ahead of you.
Thank you, Senator Whitehouse. Senator Portman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And to Dr. Yellen, thank you very much for your time you gave me recently to talk about many of the issues that I know have come before the committee today. I'm going to revisit one that I'm sure has been talked about, which is the fiscal discipline question. A Treasury Secretary can be very powerful within an administration, providing a voice for fiscal sanity, and I would urge you to do that. Our conversation was about the relatively low interest rate environment and the fact that you think that investments are needed and that going into further deficits and adding to our debt is appropriate. I would hope, again, that although we do have relatively low rates today, knowing that that could change, we shouldn't get too comfortable with that. And second, that we have historic levels of deficits now, and as a percent of our GDP, not seen since World War II, which is frightening. One quick story, when I was OMB director under the Bush administration, this is a long time ago, 14 years ago, I wanted to propose a balanced budget over 5 years, and there was the ability to do that only 14 years ago. Think about that, a balanced budget, not over 10 years, but over 5 years in the budget. There was quite a debate in the administration at the time, and frankly, I think I was on the losing end of it until somebody weighed in, and that was Hank Paulson, who was then Secretary of the Treasury. And I always be grateful for him for that. I think it was the right thing to do. At least it showed that we could get to a balanced budget by making some tough decisions. And the Treasury Secretary obviously was someone who people were listening to from an economic point of view. So with that, I don't know that I've posed a question, but I would love to hear your response to what you see as your responsibility to be a voice of fiscal sanity within the administration.
I completely agree with you, Senator Portman, that the Treasury Secretary has to be a voice for fiscal sanity, and I pledge to do that. Our finances need to be on a sustainable long-run course, and that's very important for us to focus on. I pledge to do that. Right now, short term, I feel that we can't afford what it takes to get the economy back on its feet, to get us through the pandemic, and to relieve the burdens that it's placing on households and small businesses. And research from other countries suggests that often spending money to address a weak economy ends up creating a lower debt burden in the long run than failing to provide that support. So that will be my focus in the short run, is getting the economy back on its feet. But longer run, there are challenges in achieving fiscal sustainability. We have to make sure ultimately the deficits that we run, if we do that, are consistent with fiscal sustainability. The world has changed. I believe the future is likely to bring low interest rates for a long time. But of course, it is a risk that interest rates can rise, and we need to consider that risk as well in crafting a sustainable and responsible policy.
Thank you. I will look forward to working with you on coming up with ways to deal with that long-term structural deficit, because we all know about it. We all know it's there. It's the mandatory spending side of the ledger. And I've talked to you about this in our conversation privately, but I do look forward to working with you on that. The Tax Cuts and Jobs Act was passed in 2017, and the resulting economic improvements were dramatic. We had, as of February, as I recall, 16 straight months of wage gains of 3% or more before COVID hit. Unbelievable. We had poverty rates at record levels since poverty rate began to be measured back in the 1950s. We'd never had a rate as low as we had going into the pandemic. And obviously unemployment was low, historically low, for many groups, including Blacks, Hispanics, and others. So this is this is a good thing. We had an opportunity economy that many of us talk about, but it actually was happening. And I think a lot of it was because of the investment that businesses were making, small and large alike, because of the tax reform that really made it more advantageous to invest in America, $482 billion in equipment, buildings, and most importantly to me, employees by U.S. businesses during this time period after the 2017 bill and before the pandemic hit. Let me ask you, if I could, about one part of that, and that is the corporate rate. My understanding is that President-elect Biden has talked about raising the corporate rate and also raising the amount of taxes that one would pay for global income, both of which I think are going to result in less investment in the United States. And the whole reason we lowered the rate was to be sure we were more or less competitive with the rest of the developed world. Our rate is still, frankly, when you include the state income tax, higher than the average, but it's about at the average, whereas before we had the highest rate among all the developed countries. And, you know, what people were doing is investing overseas, not in America. And we were losing jobs, we were losing businesses, companies were inverting, losing investment, and much of that has started to come back. It's been a good thing. The bill introduced a concept of not just lower rates, but also this global, intangible, low-taxed income, the GILTI regime, which is very complicated, but basically it's anti-base erosion, meaning that it effectively acts like a minimum tax on foreign earnings of U.S. companies. Prior to that, companies could just defer their taxes forever because our rates were so high, people deferred and deferred and deferred. Now they have to pay it, and it's, you know, it is kind of a minimum tax. The high U.S. tax rate we had before made the deferral necessary, but it also caused this lockout of foreign earnings as a barrier to U.S. investment, again, created incentives for acquisitions of U.S. companies by foreign companies, they could get a better deal. So we both lowered the rate and eliminated deferral. As a result, we've created a more level playing field. I just am worried about these proposals to both increase the corporate tax and to double the rate, as I understand it, on GILTI, on this minimum tax from 10.5% to 21%. It would put us again in a non-competitive situation relative to our OECD trading partners. And, you know, the OECD right now is considering a global minimum tax rate of 12.5%. So they're going the opposite way because they get it. This creates more jobs in their countries. So I hope that you will push back against that, understanding that, you know, you may not approve all of the tax cuts and tax reforms that were in there, but certainly on the business side, this created an incentive to invest in America.
Senator Portman, also the
ability to write off your investment.
Senator Portman, we are on a time schedule here because another committee needs to take this room. So could I ask that to be a question for the record?
Great. Well, I would love to hear your response in the record for that. Again, I appreciated our conversation on that and other issues, and I look forward to hearing from you. Thank you.
Thank you. And Dr. Yellen, I know you've responded to that type of question a couple of times, but if you could give a very thorough response in the question for the record, because I thought that was a very well-stated question.
Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you. Next, we will return to Senator Casey.
Mr. Chairman, you can hear me now.
Yes, we got you.
Okay. Thanks. Dr. Yellen, thank you for your willingness to serve the American people again. We're grateful for that. I wanted to focus my questions, maybe two broad questions, mostly on children, but they'll touch on other issues as well. First of all, the role of both child care and early childhood education, so-called early care and learning.
the importance of that to the economy, and in particular to the labor force participation by women, which we know is a major challenge we have. The pandemic has exposed the importance of caregiving on our economy, those who care for and support children, who support and care for seniors and people with disabilities. We're seeing more clearly now, probably than ever, the importance of quality, affordable care for those Americans and the connection between that care and our economy. In President-elect Biden's American Rescue Plan, he included a provision very close to my bill, the Child and Dependent Care Tax Credit, the expansion of that. And so I just wanted to ask you about both the question of childcare and the care economy as an economic imperative to the country. If you could discuss both your ability to elevate this issue, both as it relates to COVID-19, as well as the importance in terms of the short and long-term competitiveness of our economy.
Well, thank you for that question, Senator. I feel this is a really critical area, both because of the pandemic and longer term. The availability of childcare and paid leave greatly affects the ability of women to participate in the labor force. And once upon a time, we had one of the highest labor force participation rates for women of any developed country, and that has really changed. And we no longer are anywhere near the top. And where we stand out is that the United States does much less on the front of childcare and paid leave than most other developed economies. And I agree, for the competitiveness of our economy and wanting women to be able to participate, it's really critical to address those shortages. And it's been more than evident in the pandemic. It's women who have suffered a disproportionate loss in jobs, who have a disproportionate burden of caring for children who are out of school and for relatives who are ill and need help. And it's really impacted them mightily and because of a lack of these supports.
Well, I appreciate that because it's I think very, very much apparent now because of the pandemic about how important those programs are and those strategies are for caregiving. But my last question before my time runs out, Dr. Yellen, is about kids' savings accounts. This has been an idea that's been around, proposed over the last 20 years. I've worked with Senator Wyden on the Young American Savers Act. It's a measure that I proposed, a similar measure, in the debate on the 2017 tax bill. The Democrats all voted for it. I think it's time finally to enact kids' savings accounts to support equity building for our nation's kids, so we can also at the same time support emergency savings for their parents. Could you discuss briefly, and I know we only have less than a minute left, the role of asset building in securing the middle class?
Well, just very briefly, Senator, I certainly agree that assets are utterly essential for people in dealing with an emergency. It's shocking that such a large fraction of Americans wouldn't have $400 to deal with an emergency. And it's necessary for home ownership, for business formation, for saving. And we have huge wealth disparities, even greater than income disparities. And the racial wealth gap has also worsened over time. So looking for strategies to address that gap and promote asset building, I think, should be very much the forefront of policy.
Well, Dr. Yellen, thanks so much. Good luck in your confirmation. I'll have some other questions for the record. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator.
Thank you, Senator Gracie. Senator Hassan.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chair and Ranking Member Wyden, for holding this important hearing and doing it today. Thank you, Dr. Yellen, for appearing before the committee and for your willingness to serve our country during this difficult time. Having someone with your expertise at the Treasury is going to be pivotal to helping struggling families and businesses as we work to contain the virus, protect and create jobs, and rebuild the economy. I have three questions that I think we can cover in our time. As we discussed when we met earlier this month, Dr. Yellen, I am working on a bipartisan effort with Senator Young to expand the research and development tax credit for small businesses. New businesses and innovative startups are a major source of job creation, which is going to be key to rebuilding our economy after we contain the virus. Dr. Yellen, could you speak to the importance of R&D investments to creating jobs and to the economic recovery? And at the Treasury, will you work with us to explore ways to support R&D through the tax code?
Thank you, Senator. Certainly, I look forward to working with you. This is a very important matter. R&D is essential to innovation and to the growth of our economy. It's made a huge contribution. And I think you're absolutely right that new businesses and innovative businesses have driven job creation. So finding ways to support R&D investments and including by smaller new businesses is something I'd look forward to working with you on.
Well, thank you, Dr. Yellen. As we continue to assist struggling businesses to keep their employees on payroll, we also need to strengthen support for the risk takers and innovators who create new jobs and help us grow the economy. Toward that end, the recent economic relief package contained a bipartisan bill that I introduced to Senator Burr to allow small businesses to both participate in the Paycheck Protection Program and to claim the Employee Retention Tax Credit. Unfortunately, according to the National Federation of Independent Businesses, one of the supporters of our bill, many small businesses remain unaware that they can receive upfront payments of the Employee Retention Credit to help keep workers on payroll and cover employee healthcare costs. Dr. Yellen, how can Treasury increase awareness of the Employee Retention Credit so that small businesses can quickly and effectively receive the full range of economic relief available?
Well, Senator, I first let me say that I think allowing these businesses to utilize both PPP and the Employee Retention Credit was a very worthwhile innovation and should really help a lot of businesses. So we want to make sure that they know about it. I will discuss this, I promise, with the IRS to see if there's something that they can do, but perhaps we can also work with nonprofits and with groups like the Federation for Small Businesses to see if we can find ways to publicize it so that they're aware that this is a benefit that's available.
Well, thank you. I think this is an important factor in helping us accelerate the recovery and protecting jobs. So thank you for your willingness to work with us on that. I wanted to switch topics a little bit to the issue of terrorist financing. In previous finance hearings with outgoing Secretary Mnuchin, I've raised the importance of Treasury programs that combat the financing of terrorist and criminal organizations. The Bipartisan National Defense Authorization Act passed earlier this month, and it included a provision led by Senator Warner that established an advisory group with Treasury to counter new ways that terrorists use emerging financial technology. One area of growing concern, for example, is the potential for terrorists and criminals to use cryptocurrency to finance their activities. So Dr. Yellen, can you outline some of these emerging technological concerns and how Treasury should combat new forms of terrorist and criminal financing?
Senator, I think you're absolutely right that the technologies to accomplish this change over time, and we need to make sure that our methods for dealing with these matters with terrorist financing change along with changing technology. Cryptocurrencies are a particular concern. I think many are used, at least in a transactions sense, mainly for illicit financing. And I think we really need to examine ways in which we can curtail their use and make sure that anti-money laundering doesn't occur through those channels.
Thank you, Doctor. Thank you, Mr. Chair. My time is up. I look forward to working with you, Dr. Yellen.
Look forward to working with you as well.
Thank you. And next is Senator Cortez Masto.
Senator Crapo.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Senator Crapo, with leave from my colleague for Nevada and in no way taking from her time, I'd just like to take maybe 90 seconds to describe where I think we are with respect to the Yellen nomination. I hope that'll be acceptable to my colleague from Nevada. Be very quick, and this does not come off her time.
Yes, please.
So the majority and the minority have been talking, and we now have an agreement that finance members, Senate finance members, will have their questions in for the nominee tomorrow.
Yeah, close of business tomorrow.
Close of business tomorrow. So my hope would be, Senator Crapo, that we could have Chair Yellen on the floor of the United States Senate on Thursday. And obviously we're taking it a day at a time, and we've made some headway here in the last hour. Deadline for Senate questions. I mean, this is a person who's been confirmed again and again and again, and has all these past Treasury secretaries in back of her. So I appreciate the discussions that we've had in the last hour. We've made some progress. I hope she'll be on the floor on Thursday. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Senator Wyden, and I will talk with Senator Grassley, and we will work with members on our side to work expeditiously. Thank you. Now, Senator Cortez Masto.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Yellen, congratulations. Thank you for the courtesy meeting last week. I'm going to try to keep it brief. It's been a long morning and afternoon for you, and thank you so much for your patience, and I enjoyed listening to all of your responses to my colleagues. Two issues, hospitality, and we talked about that, and the other is housing. So let me just talk a little bit about, as you well know, in Nevada, we've been so hard hit. Before the pandemic, the travel and tourism industry was one of the largest sectors of the economy. In 2019, travel generated $1.1 trillion in spending and supported 15.8 million American jobs. But the COVID-19 pandemic has devastated the travel industry more than any other sector of the economy. And according to Oxford Economics, the U.S. lost $510 billion in travel spending and 4.5 million travel jobs in 2020. So my question to you is, what are your recommendations for addressing this hardest hit serviced sector economy and its workers, like those in Nevada and across the country?
Well, Senator Cortez Masto, I'm really aware of just how badly the Nevada economy has been impacted by the pandemic because of the focus on travel, tourism, leisure activities. This is, as you said, the hardest hit sector with the most pain and job loss. And getting this pandemic addressed and over with so people can go back about their lives and travel and enjoy leisure activities, that is top of agenda. And in the meantime, making sure that we support the workers and the businesses that have been so badly affected, giving them the aid they need to get through this, come out the other side, and to help state and local governments in a variety of ways, reopen schools, make sure that you don't have to fire emergency workers because of the budget pressures that your state faces and others.
Thank you, Dr. Yellen. But let me be a little bit specific. Last fall, Senator Kramer and I introduced a bipartisan bill. It's the Hospitality and Commerce Job Recovery Act. And what it does is it provides refundable tax credits for businesses and individuals to boost demand for travel once it's safe to travel again. I'm curious, what are your thoughts are? Can tax credits be effective tools to incentivize spending and help certain sectors like the service sector and travel sector recover and the economy turn around?
Well, Senator, I'd be glad to take a look at that and work with you and examine the details more fully.
I appreciate that. Thank you. As you said in your introduction, you know that the sector, particularly the service sector, has been so disproportionately impacted. We need to continue to provide relief and investments in this sector. So I'm hopeful that you and the Biden administration will work with us moving forward. Housing. I know I have about a minute left. Let me ask you this. And this was an issue. Nevada is literally dealing with an affordable housing crisis that started even before this pandemic. I know it's happening across the country. And we talked a little bit about this. Could you really address how Treasury Department can work with us to, as well as the Biden-Harris administration, to address what we see in affordable housing crisis across the country?
It's a huge problem, Senator, and we really need to devise effective ways to work on this and support affordable housing. Things like the low-income housing tax credit, I think, have been very important, and we need to come up with other innovative strategies because this really is a crisis in many parts of the country.
Well, I know my colleague, Senator Cantwell, mentioned this to you as well. During this hearing. I look forward to working with you as well as the Biden administration to address this issue. Thank you again for your willingness to serve.
Thank you, Senator. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Senator Cortez Masto. Senator Young.
Dr. Yellen, it's good to see you again. I enjoyed our visit the other day. Congratulations once again on your nomination. I would like to ask you, for starters, about some questions about our hardest hit businesses. It has been widely reported that we are in the midst of a K-shaped recovery where Wall Street doing pretty well, so many of our small businesses doing well, in fact, record profits we've seen from a number of them. Meanwhile, a number of our Main Street firms are if not hollowed out, certainly just pockmarked with businesses that are shuttered on account of this pandemic and associated public health measures. In your July 17 testimony before a House subcommittee, you indicated, Doctor, that there would be scars left on the economy. And by that, I infer you probably meant an erosion of skills within our workforce, a loss of innovation that tends to occur among these small firms, to say nothing of the future opportunities for growth. In the state of Indiana, it's estimated that one in four small businesses face closure, including, you know, generations deep family businesses that have really become pillars within given communities. So there's a social and cultural dimension to this as well. That's all if economic conditions do not improve. Blessedly, we've invented these vaccines and the economy will be opening up. And we have a relief package that we came together and passed to the American people before year's end. In light of that relief that we have offered, it seems to be making a difference. And there seem to be some sunnier days ahead. What do you expect the need to be for additional small business assistance, and why do you expect that need to exist to a particular level?
Well, unfortunately, I fear we have some very difficult months ahead before the vaccine has been widely enough disseminated to really open up the economy and let people get back to their regular lives, going out to eat at restaurants and engage in entertainment and things that involve face-to-face contact. So I think the PPP funding included in the last bill is tremendously important. We are going to do everything we can to work with the Small Business Administration to get that support out as quickly and as effectively as we can. These small businesses are the lifeblood of their communities and provide a disproportionate share of jobs in America. And so supporting them, I think of scarring as not only affecting workers, but when businesses fail that have been the backbones of their communities, that's permanent job loss for workers and a tragedy for the communities. So this is certainly something we want to do. And if more funding is needed, we would come back and ask for that. We've asked for some money from grants for the smallest businesses and some funding to support state and local nonprofits in getting assistance out.
Well, and I have to say, that seems prudent to me, Doctor. It's my sense, informed by conversations with people on the ground, as well as economists, that there will be additional assistance needed for some of our hardest hit businesses. We're going to have to continue to monitor that. I think that's the right approach. I also sense it's prudent, again, after consultation with others, to hold off of certain campaign promises that might have been made. And I want to get your perspective on that, in particular, tax increases in the middle of a global pandemic, which has triggered this massive economic downturn.
So the focus now is not on tax increases, it's on programs to help us through the pandemic. But we also, the president-elect also wants to pursue his Building Back Better agenda to strengthen the economy, make sure that we create good jobs at good wages for workers and invest in infrastructure and our people. And in that context, there may be a need for additional financing. We shouldn't think about tax increases in the abstract. I think anything that is proposed should be focused on corporations and on high-income individuals and in the context of a larger program.
Yes, Doctor. So I won't focus on the abstract. Let me get very particular. Are there any elements of the revenue-raising portions of the Build Back Better plan that you believe should be reconsidered?
I'm not sure what you have in mind. There have been a few things that have been specified, but probably not a complete program. President-elect Biden has proposed increasing the corporate tax and making American companies that offshore jobs, reducing those incentives. And in doing that, I think worrying about the competitiveness of American business would propose to do this in the context of global agreements on corporate minimum taxes.
I'm grateful for the answer. I'll have to probably submit some follow-up questions for the record pertaining to the loss of jobs. Should companies invert, that is, send their headquarters overseas with seeking lower corporate tax rates, which was one of the reasons that the rate was lowered initially. But nonetheless,
we need to avoid that for sure.
Yes. Oh, good. We agree on that as a matter of principle. You and I discussed my proposal with Senator Bennett to create a long-term working capital loan program for our hardest hit businesses. It's called the Restart Act. 60 bipartisan co-sponsors were earned here in the United States Senate, roughly 180 in the House of Representatives, and thousands of small businesses in Indiana and across the country were supportive of this. To the extent we need additional small business relief, and you've indicated we might, is this something that you might work with me and Senator Bennett to try and perfect and perhaps implement in a bipartisan way?
Absolutely. I would look forward to working with you on that.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Senator Young. Senator Sass.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Yellen, congratulations on your nomination. Obviously, an important capstone to a very distinguished career. I want to focus on a set of topics that involve the national security equities of the Treasury Department more than some of the topics of the last couple of questions. It is my view that whenever the Senate is fulfilling our advice and consent obligations with regard to any senior position that has national security equities, one of our obligations is to make sure that the nominee in question regards herself or himself as having a national security portfolio. And secondarily, I think it's clear that there is a bipartisan consensus in the Senate now. I come to you having just been in an Intelligence Committee hearing first open and then closed. And the bipartisan consensus is overwhelming, that the number one long-term geopolitical threat the United States faces, not just in the next 4 years, but probably in the next four decades, is the Chinese Communist Party. So I want to ask you two questions about that first. Dr. Yellen, do you believe that the Secretary of the Treasury is a national security position in the president's cabinet?
Absolutely. I think Treasury, along with rest of the administration, needs to stay laser focused on that. We have many tools that are implemented through Treasury to address national security concerns. The Treasury leads the CFIUS process and have sanctions and enforcement actions that can serve to dismantle financial and support networks of those who seek to do us harm, and certainly leadership of Treasury is important, and it's a priority.
Thank you. I'm glad to hear you say that, Dr. Yellen. Both the CFIUS point and the portfolio and the sanctions regime, I also in the past have chaired the subcommittee of banking that deals with sanctions, and I agree with you that you have a very important and professional staff in that area, and I'm glad to hear that you regard it as a priority. Do you regard the Chinese Communist Party as an existential threat to the United States?
Well, I regard China as our most important strategic competitor, and feel it's necessary to devise an administration-wide and multifaceted approach to address the threats that China causes. And certainly we need to target illicit activities that are linked to theft of intellectual property and trade secrets, illegal efforts to acquire critical technologies and sensitive U.S. data, and fentanyl traffic, among other things.
Thank you. I agree with your list. In addition, I wonder if you would regard Chairman Xi and his regime as guilty of genocide in Xinjiang at present.
I think it's guilty of horrendous human rights abuses, yes.
Thank you. I do think the word, not to quibble here, won't make you respond precisely to the word genocide, but I think it is important for us to recognize what has been happening in Xinjiang as a genocide. And so it is not just one issue among many where we can sort of varnish it as merely a geopolitical competitor. Chairman Xi's regime is evil, and they are raping and torturing Uyghur women at present. So I think we need to be well aware of the nature of the regime we're dealing with. Obviously, one of the most important pieces for the purposes of thinking about the future of the U.S. economy is the long-term technology race we face with China. For years, American economic and technological innovation have fueled the CCP's mastery of the digital economy, and then they've gone on to use that mastery of the digital economy to do a parade of horribles, some of which you just listed. Importantly, could you walk us through how you think about a review of our technological interdependence with China? And do you believe that some degree of decoupling is going to be incumbent upon us in the next 4 years?
Well, I do think that we face a significant competition with China and need to address the subsidies that China's put in place and other policies to erode our technological edge. I think first and foremost, we have to make sure that we as an economy make the investments that enable us to compete with China, investments in manufacturing and infrastructure and training and research and development that are ultimately our sources of economic strength. But we need to aggressively counter unfair practices that China uses, whether it's to enforce technology transfer or to invest in ways in the United States that that are dangerous to our national security.
Thank you. I agree with you that there are a number of strategic areas where we are underinvesting, from AI to quantum to biotech to robotics, machine learning, et cetera. But as relates to 5G in particular and Huawei, could you use that as a case study to talk us through kind of how you think our policy should be unfolding in the 5G space and how we should be trying to bring together allies to battle the unfair practices that we see from Huawei around the world?
And Senator Sass, may I ask that you make that a QFR, because we're running against a tight deadline here?
Yes, Chairman. Dr. Yellen, I will make that a QFR. And again, congratulations on your nomination, and we look forward to working with you on these topics.
Thank you, Senator Sass.
Thank you, Senator Sass. We are running up against a tight deadline here because we have to have the committee of this room available for another committee. But we're going to return to two senators, Senator Toomey and Senator Menendez, and then we will wrap up the hearing. And with that, Senator Toomey.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Yellen, I want to talk just a little bit about housing finance reform, I should say, which I think is in some ways the great unfinished business of the financial crisis. As you know, the GSEs, Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, are still in conservatorship, still perceived as too big to fail. Now they hold almost no capital. But Secretary Mnuchin and Director Calabria of the FHFA did take some significant steps that seemed to me steps in the right direction. While I would have preferred going further, at least there is an end to the automatic profit sweep. There is the opportunity to build up capital through retained earnings. There is a capital target now for the GSEs, and there are rules that are meant to limit the acquisition of the riskiest loans by the GSEs. Have you had a chance to look at these reforms, and have you determined that you would support leaving them in place?
Senator Toomey, it's a very important matter. Nothing is more important to the future of housing in the United States than what we do with Fannie and Freddie. And I need to look carefully at what's been put in place. And ultimately, we need to find a solution that has bipartisan support and to work with Congress to craft an approach.
Okay. Will you commit to developing and releasing reform principles for both on the regulatory side as well as on the legislative side?
We will certainly give priority to studying this issue and coming up with ideas about what should be done.
Okay. And just quickly to follow up on the conversation we had the other day about the FSOC designations, one of my concerns has always been that SIFI designations create the expectations of a taxpayer bailout should a problem occur. In a way, it designates the firms that are so designated as too big to fail. Interestingly, certain categories of financial institutions have not been designated, and it occurs to me that certain business models are inherently less of a risk to our financial system. For instance, asset managers that simply hold assets on behalf of investors, as opposed to banks that intermediate credit and transform maturity. Asset managers have not been designated as SIFIs thus far. Do you agree with the decision that's been made not to designate asset managers as SIFIs thus far?
Well, when I served on FSOC as Fed chair, it was proposed to look at activities that asset managers engage in that might pose systemic risks. And a paper was issued that mentioned problems of possibly looking at high leverage in hedge funds. A working group was formed that was to look at, I think it's since been disbanded, the matter of whether or not some hedge funds have dangerous levels of leverage, open-end mutual funds that promise daily redemption and liquidity, that invest in assets that are relatively illiquid, can pose problems. And I think we saw some of those problems in March.
One, two.
Decision. And I would point out that the money market funds have been remarkably stable and successful. But I appreciate that and look forward to working with you on these and other issues. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator Toomey. And is Senator Menendez back? I'm being told that he has not been able to make it back. And so that will conclude the questioning. Dr. Yellen, you've made it through to the end of the hearing. I know this was a long day for you, and we appreciate the fact that you are willing to serve, that we congratulate you on your nomination. And as you've probably heard in some of the discussion, a number of the senators will want to submit to you questions for the record. Some have already been stated here during the questioning period. Others will be submitted in writing. Those questions for the record are due by close of business tomorrow. And as Senator Wyden indicated, the committee does want to move expeditiously. So we ask you, Dr. Yellen, to please respond to these questions for the record as quickly as possible. We would like some thorough answers to some of these, to all of these questions, but please respond to these as quickly as possible. And with that, again, Dr. Yellen, thank you so much for being here with us today. And this hearing is concluded.